So as a prosecutor, what is your biggest frustration in terms of not being able to prosecute certain cases the way you would like them to?
Well, without a doubt, the biggest frustration is that by the time the reports are made to law enforcement and we contact the providers and ask for records, those records are gone. One example, for text messages, for example, most of the major cell phone providers don't keep text messages at all. There's a couple that will keep them 3 to 5 days. One will hold them up to 12 days. But if the victim doesn't make a report immediately and law enforcement doesn't act to preserve that information, it's gone. And it's the same with email. Most email providers don't keep deleted email beyond 30 days. They purge it from their system like the cell phone providers purge their text messages. And then the other big thing that we're always looking for are internet logs that would contain IP addresses. Those are kept only for short periods of time as well. So what we would actually like to see is Congress pass a law, a bill that's pending before them right now that would require service providers to retain records up to 2 years. If that law were to pass, then we would have at least 2 years worth of records going back from the date of the incident, and that would enable us to generate the electronic information that we need to trace email or money transactions back to the perpetrator and hopefully identify the person who is perpetrating the schemes.
Is there any pushback right now from some of the internet providers to push Congress to not pass that law?
Well, there has been opposition, not surprisingly, coming from the internet service provider industry, cell phone provider industry, even the social networking provider industry. They don't want, obviously, to keep 2 years worth of data on their servers. And, you know, they have legitimate concerns that need to be addressed, but I think the bigger concern is we see an increase in cybercrime. There's a lot of anonymity out there. People are starting to realize that they can facilitate bigger crimes, targeting more people, higher dollar losses all through the internet. And so we really need their cooperation to retain information and make it available to law enforcement when we serve them with the appropriate legal process.
Now tell me about your frustration with the spoofing. And spoofing, I just learned that term at our cybercrime informational briefing, and that is when people send an email, just like what you said, the stranded traveler. How is it hard for prosecutors to deal with the spoofing where it looks like it's coming from your friend, but it's not?
Well, you know, one recent example, we had a case involving a guy who was using a smartphone that had internet capability, and he had loaded spoofing software onto the smartphone. And basically what that software did was every time he sent an email ordering merchandise with someone else's credit card over the internet, that software inserted a different IP address than the one that was associated with that phone. So spoofing software, in effect, alters the originating IP address of the device used to initiate the communication. So where it impacts law enforcement is when we get email or internet logs and we read that, we see the IP address that we believe is associated with the device used to perpetrate the scheme. But when we track that down with the internet service provider, we find out that that number either doesn't exist or it's assigned to someone in a different location, or it's just somebody who we determine is obviously innocent. You know, that's a big problem. But the other really big problem is that more and more bad guys are starting to use wireless open hotspots to initiate their fraud schemes. So we'll get our internet logs from Roadrunner, for example, and that IP address will be assigned to a wireless router at the local coffee shop. And if they don't have a video or an employee who can tell us who was in the shop at that time that this transaction was initiated, it makes it almost impossible to identify the suspect. So more and more bad guys are doing that, taking advantage of the free wireless unsecured routers out there. We also had a case where the suspect drove around a neighborhood in Kailua and got onto a wireless router and perpetrated an extortion scheme involving nude pictures of a woman. Mm. And when we went to the house, the couple that lived there were an older couple in their 60s, and we quickly realized that they weren't involved, but we also found out that they had a wireless router and it wasn't secured. We ended up catching that suspect who lived a few houses away, but unsecured wireless routers pose a very big problem for us because the question we're always asking is, how do we know that this IP address used to facilitate this crime isn't assigned to an unsecured wireless router? And we really need to know that before we use a search warrant to go into someone's house. So that's definitely a big challenge for us.
So maybe over time, as people get more educated, they will secure their routers, because a lot of people don't know. They think that everything is trusted, but there's criminals that take advantage of that trust.
You're right.
What are some of the other things that you hope the legislature will do in this next legislative session to help law enforcement prosecute cybercrime?
Well, one of the things that I hope they would consider is a bill that would, in effect, give our legal process extraterritorial jurisdiction. And by that I mean most of the internet service providers, the cell phone providers, even Roadrunner, all of these companies maintain their records on the mainland. And yet when local and state law enforcement conducts a cybercrime investigation, our legal process is initiated via a local court. So that could be a subpoena, a court order, a search warrant. So we need a bill that would tell service providers on the mainland that you have to honor a legal process that's issued by a Hawaii state judge. If you want to do business in Hawaii, you have to honor our legal process. And so that would help us a lot, because right now there are some providers that will not honor a Hawaii state legal process, a subpoena or a court order, and we'll have to work with the local jurisdiction where that provider's located, and that takes time. And
I understand you said California has a very strong law relating to this.
Right. There are five states now that have a law. It's basically a long-arm statute that allows Hawaii law to extend to the location of where the records are. And so, yeah, California, New York, Washington, Minnesota, and Florida have those laws. So we have a bill drafted and ready to go, and we're hopeful that the legislature will consider that. Without that sort of law, it really slows down the investigation, and it makes it harder for us to get evidence before it's deleted from the provider's servers.
And also, you had mentioned at our seminar making our cybercrime laws as tough as our identity theft laws.
Right. I think that if you look at our identity theft laws, they're actually very strong. If somebody misuses personal information and causes a loss of $20,000, that's a Class A felony punishable by a 20-year prison sentence. Our computer crime laws are not nearly as tough as our identity theft laws. So we're hopeful that the legislature will consider looking, especially our computer fraud statutes. Right now, we can't use those statutes because they include this requirement that we prove the suspect didn't have authorization to use the computer that he or she used to facilitate a fraud. But most computer frauds are facilitated by a defendant using his or her own computer. So adding that element to the crime made it very difficult for us to use that statute. In fact, we rarely use that statute. So we're hopeful that the legislature will go back and look at that statute. Look at how it was when it was first created back in the 1980s. It was much broader. And I think if they're willing to do that, we'll come out with a stronger computer fraud statute. I think that's real critical because the number one category of cybercrime is internet fraud. You know, people are using the computers to facilitate fraud schemes. And so we need that if we're going to address problems like advanced fee scams, the online auction scams, or non-delivery of merchandise scams, even a lot of these counterfeit check scams that are all initiated via the internet. So hopefully we can work on that and make that crime a little stronger.
We want to congratulate you for your many prosecutions. Despite our weaker laws, your office, and I know a lot of the detectives and the police officers have somehow found a way to do a great job despite that. And so we hope to provide you with better laws that will make it a lot easier for you folks to do your job. Well, Chris, thanks so much for coming to visit us.
Thank you for having me.
And we're going to be talking about cybercrime a lot in the next year. So thank you folks for joining us. And our next segment will be about how, as you as a consumer, can protect yourself. So stay safe out there. And thank you for joining us. Aloha.